Hey everyone, in this video, we're going to be talking about cubic spline interpolation theory. We're going to begin with a brief overview of spline interpolation, define what cubic spline interpolation is, speak about why it is used, and then lastly we'll walk through how to implement a cubic spline interpolation. Cubic spline interpolation is a powerful technique used to approximate a smooth curve that passes through a set of data points. Similar to the linear and quadratic splines that we have talked about in our past few videos, it breaks down the data range into smaller segments. However, we are now going to fit a cubic polynomial to each section. And this ensures continuity and smoothness at the connection points, which is something we were lacking in both the linear and quadratic splines. So, let's imagine that we have a system where we are tracking the amount of time that it takes to fill a bucket. As you can see, we are given 5 discrete data points, but we are interested in making a function that passes through all of our relevant data points. There are various types of spline interpolation, as we have talked about, including linear and quadratic. In brief, a linear spline interpolation simply connects our data points using straight lines, or a first-order spline, which, although simple, tends to lead to inaccurate interpolations as there is no curvature in our function. Secondly, a quadratic spline fits a second-order polynomial to our interpolation function, and this adds curvature to our interpolating function, but we only have one degree of freedom, which forces us to use parabolas and parabolas alone. Now we will talk about the most common type of spline interpolation, that being cubic spline interpolation. Unlike the quadratic splines, what makes cubic spline interpolation powerful is that it ensures continuity and smoothness at the connection points. This means that the curve and its derivative up to the second order are continuous throughout the entire range, whereas in quadratic spline interpolation, this is only true for the first derivative. Now, let's explore the benefits of using cubic spline interpolation. Firstly, it provides a more accurate representation of the data compared to simpler interpolation methods. The smoothness and continuity properties ensure that the interpolated curve captures the overall trend without excessive oscillations. So now that we have an idea of why cubic splines are useful, let's talk about how to use cubic splines. So, between each connection point, we are going to have a third-order polynomial, that being a cubic spline. So, imagining a set of data that looks like this, each point that we wish to interpolate through will be described as the following general cubic polynomial. Therefore, this will create a set of polynomial equations that look like this that we need to solve the coefficients for. And we will have n equations. Now all we need to do is develop a methodology for how we are going to solve for all of these unknowns. The first thing we need to do is determine how many unknowns we actually need to solve for. Well, as you can probably imagine, the number of unknowns that we need to solve for depends on the number of cubic splines that we are interpolating for. Therefore, we can say that for every spline n, we will have 4n unknowns, meaning that we need to find 4 equations per spline that we add. Let's try to find our 4n equations. Firstly, we will have some known data points. These are the input-output pairs that we are interpolating through. Because each data point will share a spline, we actually get 2n equations. Therefore, we just need to find 2n more equations to be able to begin solving our system of equations. For our intermediate data points, we can define continuity and say that the first derivatives need to be equal. This statement will be true at every interior data point that we have, and this will give us n-1 equations. Therefore, we are missing n-1 equations still. Likewise, we know that we actually want our interior data points to also have equal second derivatives, as we want our splines to be as smooth as possible. Therefore, this is going to be another n-1 equations. This leaves us with -2 equations. We have some options at this point. However, the most common way to find these two missing equations is is through making some assumptions about the endpoints of our piecewise spline function, much like we did for the quadratic spline interpolation. The first common approach is a natural cubic spline, which ensures that the curve is continuous and has 0 second derivatives at the endpoints of each interval. Therefore, we get two equations by setting our first and last data points' second derivatives to zero, whereas a clamped cubic spline requires some extra data. We specify the slopes, the rate of change of the curve at the first and last data point. These slopes are called the clamped conditions. By providing these clamped conditions, we ensure that the curve has the desired slope at the endpoints, which can be helpful when we have prior knowledge or constraints about the behavior of our curve. It is worth noting that these are not the only two ways we can find our missing equations. They are just the most common. Other variations do exist, but they'll find two equations through playing with various boundary conditions and constraints. Lastly, all you need to do is solve your system of linear equations, which we have talked about plenty in the past. I hope that this video helped your understanding of what a cubic spline interpolation is, and in the next few videos, we will be walking through an example of a natural cubic spline and a clamped cubic spline example, so I highly recommend you check out those videos. If you enjoyed, please like, subscribe, and consider checking out our YouTube memberships by clicking that join button down below. However, if you have any comments, questions, or concerns about the information I provided in this video, please leave a comment down below, and I will do my best to address your concerns.